is fading. Your journey is ending. They tell me you'll never come again. My heart is heavy from holding so tightly to only a memory. Daylight is fading. The leaves have fallen. Feeling so cold now inside my.
Hi. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
And to all fathers and grandfathers here, happy Father's Day. Welcome to Harold Baptist. Whether you're a regular here or this is your first time in a church or if you're watching online. Don't know, I'm Leanne. Today, Taiwo and I will be leading today's service and worship together as Minister Andrew's on holiday. We'll be doing some short sharings on some of the men in our lives and that God has blessed us with, and we hope that you'll be blessed by today's service. So, before we go on, there's some notices. Holiday at home. So we're really starting to plan for the next holiday at home, which will most likely be on 5th September. More details will be posted, but if you're interested in helping, please speak to Andrew or Penny on your availability. And church activities throughout the week, the church is open for prayers and like as usual activities such as coffee mornings. More information will be on your notice sheet, the front of your notice sheet. And now, Taiwo will lead us in prayer to prepare ourselves to worship and meet God.
Good morning, church. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we are thankful for yet another day in your presence, in sharing and celebrating the fathers and the fine faces of our lives. We thank you. Our loved ones who have stood in this position. You are the Father of all. Father, today we ask that you bless our worship and that we pray as you have taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We'll be taking our first hymn today, Great is Thy Faithfulness, with Yobing at the piano.
to you about my father. Some of you have known me when I come to this church, and you have met my mother, because she came here when I graduated during my master's in 2021. But maybe you are also wondering, why didn't my father come for my graduation? So, my dad is a simple man. He doesn't like traveling. He's very happy to stay at home. They keep it clean, take it easy, relax. Even on family trips, there's like a handful I can come, he joins us. Because most of the time, he lets my mom or my grandparents take us to wherever. And you always say, oh, it's okay, you need someone to take care of the house. You know, but when we come back, he will be like, he starts complaining, oh, I have so much to do, I have to clean the house, you will get a venting in Singapore, you know, who is feeding the dog me, who is watering the plants me, that's kind of weird, actually. Yeah, but it doesn't mean that my dad doesn't want to spend time with my brothers and I. He does, but he doesn't know how to do it. You know, he will complain that we can't speak Cantonese. Alice here. Okay. Oh, Alice is here. Okay, yeah. So I'm going to say something in Cantonese. I think only she will know. He will always say things like, I'm sick of Guangdonghua. So what basically what my dad said is, oh, my girl is so useless. She doesn't know how to speak Cantonese. And I will always, but only recently I will challenge him back. But you don't speak Cantonese with her. That's why I can't speak. yeah, and sometimes if my brothers and I are debating during dinner, he would interject and he would derail the conversation. You know, sometimes he gives us advice, sometimes it's unsolicited advice, but sometimes it's good advice. Other times he will make, not sure all dads do this, but I know my dad definitely does. He will make dad jokes. This is a very specific joke that he makes because it's not the usual dad joke you get. So one time, because we watch a lot of Korean dramas, so one time he told us, I know how to speak Korean. And before I could go, what? He was like, Samsung Kaminada. And then he immediately explained, actually what I just said, said something very fast. He said, what I just said was Samsung Kami Ada. In Malay, that translates to we have Samsung. I know it's a very specific Malay joke, so maybe you don't get it, but that's my dad. yeah, and so while my dad doesn't know how to also simply ask us how is our day, it's very awkward in his conversations with us. He's also always offering something. As he works in a creative field, he's always offering to help me with my art projects. And even though he calls me useless, if I ask him something, how do I translate this into Cantonese? He will tell me the answer. To him, it's because it seems like I'm taking initiative to learn Cantonese. So he's, you know, at least he's pleased about that. When I need a ride home, he says I can always count on him and I can call him to pick me up. There was one time in my life that I was working very late nights. Every night I'll take the Uber home because that was the safest option than to take bus home. But there was one night I was so tired of everything, I was so tired of spending my money on another Uber ride that I just decided, okay, why don't I call my dad on an off chance. Hopefully he will help me out. He came and he told me, if you need another ride, it's okay. Just call me, I'll be awake. So my dad is not the perfect father. I'm sure a lot of you can say that, what it is. And just like my dad, he wants to spend time with us. And he wants to give us good things. He wants us to depend on him and expect from him. So as we go on to the rest of the service, I hope that we will be blessed in our walk with God and that we continue to enrich and do better in our lovely relationships with each other. So, okay, we're going to sing our next song. It's, I think you might have heard about it. I'm not sure. I've seen previous order of service we have this song, but maybe Mark sang it. So we will slowly lead you into it. Just let me figure out the
thank you.
Yes, and now Taiwo will be sharing about her husband.
Hello everyone again. That song was such a beautiful song. It just outlines the ability of a good father. And I'm grateful for God for all the fathers and all the father figures and all the grandfathers in the house. I'll be sharing about my husband today. You know, and he graciously joined the service with us this morning. His name is Ben, and he's sitting right over there. I had most of my father at the age of four, and I was raised with four other siblings in a single parent household. While I was growing up, I had this vision of who a father should be. I had a stepfather, but he also died, unfortunately. And every day I would vision who I wanted as a father and everything that a father was to me. And the list grew shorter as I grew older, because, as they say, my expectations were not met. I did not meet people who had those figures. As I grew up and I went into the university, I was on and off with relationships, but there was something I was always looking for. I was always looking for these father figures. And I would not find them, and I would break off from those relationships. I met my husband at the place I least expected. At a cousin's wedding, I actually did not like her, and I didn't want to go. But I was bribed by my mom with goodies, so I went. And before then, I had met his best friend, who unfortunately is late now. And I got to the wedding, and there was this guy, you know, sitting down with my friends, and we chatted, we talked. And at the wedding party, we danced. I love dancing, and my husband is an incredible dancer. And he said something that night. He said, "This is the way we dance for our wedding." And I laughed, because I was not the one that thought I would ever get married. I was the independent girl that just thought, because my list had grown shorter, so at a point, I didn't even think I would ever get married, because I didn't have a father figure growing up. And we started dating, you know, and I didn't pay too much attention to him, but every other person did pay attention to him, but not me. So there was this day I had gone out with my friends, and my mom was moving houses. So me being the lazy one, I didn't want to move with her, I didn't want to go anywhere. So she had been calling my phone, but I didn't pick up the phone. So later in the evening, I spoke to her and she said, she moved this today, and she met this young man. He came to help her move, and he made his intentions, you know, known to her. You would think I would be happy. I was upset. I was like, I was telling my friends, why would you go and do such a thing? But at some point, you know, in the course of us dating, I started to see this man. I started to take the boxes that I thought I needed, you know, and 3 years down the line, we got married. And we've been together for 15 years. And he's a wonderful husband, a wonderful father. You know, the boxes I was ticking was, you can understand that a mother shows their children love. But a father's role is to show a child his worth. My children feel worthy in their dad's arms. There are many things they would never come to me for that they would go to their dad. My daughter is 10, mouthy. Everything she wants is by her dad. My son, quiet, but he's as his dad should be. There's a quiet side to his dad that is also me. My husband is very sacrificial. I tell people, I boast, you know, I was supposed to say you boast to the Lord, I boast to my husband. So if my husband has £1 million, I can guarantee that I'll get £900,000. That's the standard. I don't even have to argue about it. Everything is always about me. He cares about how I feel. He's very mindful of the things that happen to me. He always wants me to be the best version of myself every day. My husband is very patient with me. When I married my husband, if my husband says one thing, I will say 20. But he will just overlook it. Sometimes, you know, he gets, he's not the kind of person I am. We can argue now, and I can, the next minute I'm off, I'm reminding you of something. My husband does it, it's not like that. He will draw out that argument because he wants you to learn a lesson. But my husband has ever been so patient with me. Every time I want something, when I want something, I want it now. I never really understood that until I met my daughter. She's the same thing. When she wants something, she wants it now. But he's able to provide that thing that I want every time and when I want it. He's the voice of reason in our house. I am very flighty. I can do something now, and I move on to something else. He thinks through everything. You know, he's always thinking ahead. So he knows where the potholes are. He knows where the mistakes are going to be made. So even when I go and I'm flighty, you know, his voice always draws me back. You know, a lot of people love him. My friends, my family, my mother absolutely adores him. My sisters, you know, my twin sister, for the first couple of years, they never got along because, you know what? Now she thinks the world of him. My husband is very, you know, it's a cliche, but he's a very responsible man. I remember when we started a business in Nigeria, and, you know, even when he didn't work, he lost a lot of money when we invested in the business. If you ask my husband will tell you he didn't lose money, he gained knowledge. And every day I would watch this man wake up. Whether he had something to do or he didn't have anything to do, he would wake up and he would get up. These things were teaching me many things in my life that I wasn't aware of until we relocated here. I knew the worth of everything that he had taught me. Today I celebrate my husband. I celebrate all the fathers who have put in the good work. There was something Roger said last time. He said, as a father, you can't mark your own script, your own homework. But we as your mothers, we as your wives, we as your sisters, we are here to mark your script. And on behalf of the women of the Harrow Baptist Church, and all the women in the world, we say thank you to the fathers. I say thank you to my husband. I say thank you to all the fathers and the grandfathers who have put in the good work. May the Lord continue to bless you and strengthen your hands in Jesus' name. Amen. Now we're taking our next hymn, How Deep.
Thank you.
or as I call him, my uncle, due to two reasons.
Is this
okay?
Will it go down?
Okay, can you hear me? Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Alright, sorry. I will try to speak more clearly and slowly. So I decided to talk about my gonggong. That's how I call my grandpa. For two reasons. Many of you here are also grandfathers. While I was trying to figure out this service, because I was not sure how to organize this service, as I'm not a father or a grandfather, just a daughter, I also asked a couple of you, you know who you are, if you could share something like a testimony or, you know, anything related to being a father or grandfather. I know it's a long shot, but I hope I didn't make it too uncomfortable with my request. But some of your comments on how you're not sure whether you're a good father or grandfather really struck something for me, and it reminded me of my gonggong. So this is my gonggong. So in Chinese culture, we have certain titles or different members of the family, depending on, the hierarchy, like whether you're the oldest or the youngest, and which side of the family you're from. So my gonggong is on my mother's side. If it's on my father's side, he will be my leye, but I have never known my leye, so my gonggong is the only grandfather I have. And I've only recently learned after his death that my mother and her siblings, they were in disagreement on whether he was a good father. Because they always say things like, oh, he's never at home, he lets mother do everything. You know, he's always trying to be the charming baseball coach with his international friends flitting around the room. Yes, my grandfather's an international. Not international, but he was a baseball coach. But to me and my brothers, he's an amazing grandfather. So this is my grandparents with most of the grandkids. I'm like in the middle. My two brothers are behind. That's my youngest cousins. We think he's amazing because he indulges us, and you know, we like to think he's the coolest gonggong in the world, because he rides a motorbike. So there was one time when we were younger, I joined a Boy Scouts program called the Royal Rangers. Me and my brothers, we joined that program. And we had an annual camp nearby, in a forest nearby where my grandfather lives. So he hears about it, and he decides to come up with his motorbike in front of everybody. So everyone's going, wow, and we're like, yes, that's our gonggong. Yes, because he's so cool, we want to show him off. And that's how we associate our gonggong, like, for his best years of his life. And that's how he provides with us, through his motorbike. If we want to have a good time, you know, just a very simple good time, he'll take us on a joyride around the neighborhood. All of us will be on it, like me and my brother, so it's not very safe. Don't try this at home, I guess. If we're spending the weekend or the school holidays with our grandparents, we will ask if, you know, we could get, can we get roti canai? Malaysia is a very diverse country, we have different cuisines, so we like roti canai the Indian cuisine. So we'll ask if we could get roti canai for breakfast. And he say, okay. He will ride on his motorbike to the nearest town to buy roti canai. If we are up early with him, he will maybe bring us along as well. And of course, it wasn't safe for him to always take us out like this. So for longer excursions, he will take his car or borrow a car from his son. And if he wanted to see us for a visit, even if we are not coming to his place for a visit, he'll come to the city anyway with his motorbike or his car, and then he'd take us out. So my Gong Gong was there when my parents couldn't be, as they were both working. And he also let us try out as many sports as we like. We're kids, so we were always changing our mind about what our favorite sport was. Like badminton, didn't stick. Football, didn't stick. I think the closest to sports that we stuck to was softball. Tennis was my dad's sport. And it didn't matter that we would lose interest, even though it was more just like, okay, you want to do this now, I'll let you do it. That was my goal. He wants us to try anyway. He wants us to explore our options, instead of just limiting to what we should be doing. So to the grandfathers here, maybe you look back and you can't think or don't think that you've been a good father. But as a grandfather, I'm sure you still want the best for your grandchildren. Just as it reads in Matthew 7, verse 9 to 11, which of you, if your son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will you give him a snake? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him? Okay, maybe some of your grandchildren are still too young to tell you you're the best or the coolest grandfather. But I can personally say for some of us who are younger in this congregation that you have looked out for us, and I just want to say that I appreciate you, and that while you're not the best father, you know, you are a better grandfather, and God bless you. Okay, Cammy will do the Bible reading for us.
This then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, as we forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Let us pray. Father, we thank you and we bless you for let us in worship. We thank you because we know your presence is here. Your word says, where two or more are gathered in your name, here you are right with us. Father, as we share your word, Father, that Lord, we ask that you open our minds and our hearts. Let the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable unto you. You are the one who is the good Father. Teach us how to parent well. Teach us how to be loving fathers and represent you here on earth. Thank you, Heavenly Father. We are grateful in Jesus' name. Amen. So fathers are the pillars of homes. You know, in the order of the Trinity, the Bible talks about God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And God being the God of order, he decided to bring down that foundation here on earth. So if you look at the structure of many homes, you will find out that you have the father, you have the wife, who is the helper and the representative of the Holy Spirit. And you have those children who are the word, or the senders, the ones you send out to go and represent who you. And God, being such a good God, he brought this structure here on earth that we may fulfill all that he has proposed for us. You know, and as today, as we celebrate fathers all over the world, we're going to be using the spiritual context, using the Lord's Prayer, to look at the qualities and the attributes of fathers. So who is a father? You know, The dictionary will explain or would define a father as a male parent who has a biological and legal relationship with a child. You know, fathers play a very significant role in the lives of their children, especially the family. They provide love, they provide support, they provide guidance, and often they share the responsibility of nurturing a child. And what is important to note that the concept of fatherhood varies depending on cultures. You have some cultures which are matriarchal in nature, you know, but largely fathers are the important foundations and pillars of homes. And as we look at the Lord's Prayer, we're going to be looking at the concept of fatherhood while Jesus was teaching his disciples. Last week, when Andrew has been taking us through the introduction of Jesus by the Gospel according to Mark, and he said something last week that stuck with me. He said, Jesus is God going public. He essentially spoke to us that there was a relationship there. You know, there was no way Jesus could manifest on this earth without his Father. Everything he did was his Father. You know, and Apostle Paul would tell us in not too many words that a son is the reflection of fatherhood. A son is given to be as his Father in all things. And the concept of the Gospel according to Luke was written to exemplify Jesus as a man. And if we look at the story of the Lord's Prayer in the book of Luke, the disciples had gone to ask Jesus, teach us how to pray. It wasn't like they were not praying, but they realized that their prayers were not effective as Jesus' prayers. They were praying. They said, teach us how to pray the way John the Baptist taught his disciples. So there was something about the prayer of John the Baptist that was hitting the mark. But they also noticed that Jesus' prayers were very effective. And Jesus began to teach them how to pray. And he said to them, in this manner, that means in this pattern. Oftentimes when we hear the Lord's Prayer, we think it's a recitation. Yes, it is indeed. But it's much more than that. What Jesus was trying to teach his disciples was the beauty of a father and a son relationship and its contribution to our prayers and how it makes our prayers very effective. So we're going to be looking at some attributes and some qualities of Father using the Lord's Prayer to identify those qualities. When Jesus taught his disciples, he said, in this manner, and he taught them, our Father. We're going to stay with that word. The first thing he said, our Father. He introduced his Father to the disciples. In the times of Jesus, the Greek was the language. The Hebrew was the language, you know, the spoken language. And the meaning of the word Father means Abba. Abba means the source. It means the sustainer. It means the one who preserves. So he introduced to them the source of all things when he said, our Father. The first line of that prayer, our Father. And who is a father in the house? A father is the source. A father is a sustainer. A father is a preserver. The father is the one who preserves the values of the house. The father is the first go-to for providing, the source of everything that happens. You know, Leanne had shared a scripture. She said, if we who are evil give good gifts to our children, how much more our Father who is in heaven? There's something about the Father that is a giver. The Father, much more than the role of source, the source is also the giver. They are the ones that give. They give love. They give time. They give their resources. There's never a lack with the Father. Oftentimes, even as we as parents, when the children can't have their way with their mothers, they go to their father because they believe they can. We think they are arm twisting their father, but there's something children understand as the father's being a source, as the father's standing and saying, okay, your mom says don't have any sweets before lunch. The father is going to give an alternative out of a careful selection. Okay, if not sweets, why don't you have an apple? Why don't you have a fruit? Or he's going to give. As opposed to a mother who said, no food, nothing before lunch. But the Father is always the source. He's always the one that preserves, and he sustains that which he provides. And when Jesus was introducing his Father to the disciples, the first thing he said is, our Father. So as children, our fathers are always the source of everything. They are the ones that sustain what we have. They have provided, and they're the ones that always preserve that which they have given us. And the foundation of fatherhood is built on love, and trust is always established. You know, the children go to the Father with a knowing. When Jesus introduced his Father, he had a knowing that every time we went to God in prayer, we said, our Father, there's a knowing that there's a source somewhere, and he provides that source. He went on to speak about a specific location. Who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Every child knows where their father is at any given time. I'd spoken earlier that the Father's foundation is built on love. Your Father has a special place in your heart. No matter wherever we go to, no matter how much we think about ourselves, even if we think that we're not good fathers, our children always have us in their hearts. You know, every child, when they approach their father, they come with a knowledge. They come with an understanding. No child goes to their father in fear or in doubt or with anxiety. They go knowing that they can ask. They go knowing that they can approach. Apostle Paul, speaking in the book of Hebrews, I believe he wrote the book of Hebrews. He said in the book of Hebrews 4, verse 16, he says we should come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain grace and find help in time of need. Children go to their fathers because they know that it's based on a conviction that they know. It's based on an understanding they know that when I go to my father is in my heart, is in my head, is in my mind, and is able to manifest everything I want from him. Hebrews 11:6, it goes, when we go to God, we go to God first because we know that he exists. And because he exists, he is a rewarder of those that diligently seek for him. So when we go to our fathers, we go to them with a knowledge and an expectation and a conviction that that which we have gone to ask will be given unto us. So when he spoke to his disciples, he said, who art in heaven? Hallowed be your name. So I bring to you an expectation and a conviction that I know that everything that I come to you for will be given unto me. And that is the quality of fatherhood. The quality of fatherhood in that regard is a knowledge. It's a knowing that every time we go to our fathers, we're going to them with convictions. Leanne spoke about her grandfather, the coolest man on the planet, as far as she and her siblings are. And her grandfather, they knew something about him. You know, her parents, her mom and her siblings might not have known, but there was a knowledge that kept them going every time, knowing that their grandfather would never refuse anything that they want to ask for. And he said, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. You know, that speaks about a father that creates a system of order. Everything your father does is to bring order and structure into a home. I spoke about my husband earlier on being the voice of reason. Many decisions we take in the house, my husband has thought them through carefully, and he knows the loopholes. So the evidence of risk coming is very minimal. Every father creates an order, and every father within a home structure knows it's their duty to make sure everyone carries out their responsibility. I spoke about God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. That cannot work one without the other, but it's coming from the Father. Everything comes from top down. The Father's role is to create order in the home, is to make sure things are run efficiently and effectively without any confusion. Everyone knows their place. And the quality that is inherent in that is accountability. As a father is accountable to not only his wife, his children, his extended family, his community, and his society. Everyone looks to a man or a father figure, to bring order and to bring systems. Oftentimes when there are wars or disagreements in nations, you find out that it's two men or two women or two disagreeing factors. The amazing thing, go and watch children playing in a playground or playing with toys. When they don't agree, there's chaos. But when they agree, there's so much laughter. There's so much joy. So in every home that there's an order, there's a father figure or there's a father that has created a system of order. They make sure everyone takes their place and takes their position. They imbibe their rules. I call them the protector of the realm. They protect their wives and their children. They are accountable to be providers. Wives help to distribute the resources. That's why they're called the helper. The Holy Spirit is the helper. He gives grace to be able to do all the things the Father has asked us to do. So when the scripture says, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on heaven, in heaven as it is on earth, that means there's something about the heavenly realm that God brings down on earth, and it allows men to carry it out. He allows we to be the custodians of those values. He imbibes his values in us and is accountable to us every day by the person of the Holy Spirit. Everything God has made us to be, the Holy Spirit helps us to achieve, align, and attain that purpose. And as he taught them, he said, give us today our daily bread and forgive our debts. A father is a provider. Every father provides. Whether you provide love, you provide support, you provide guidance. Sometimes you will provide discipline. But as a father, he's a provider. And one of the qualities of a provider is capacity. Fathers are stretched thin. I see fathers work two jobs, three jobs. We were asking Brian, to speak, and he said, oh, he wasn't sure he was a good father. And the story he said, well, he just got married, that he had to work jobs to be able to provide for his family. All I saw in that story was a provider, a man who has stretched his capacity. There was nothing he couldn't give. There was nothing he couldn't do for his family. He would stretch himself to any length. Every father has the capacity to be a provider because we were made in the image and in the likeness of God. God is the provider. The Bible says in Psalm 24, it says, the earth is the Lord and its fullness thereof. Everything belongs to God. And God deploys the resources to us in many ways. Even enjoying the nature. We're talking about the sun coming up at the same time. The seasons changing. It's God that can do such things. And children don't have to worry about their needs being met. They look unto their parents or their fathers for their needs to be met. But children don't worry about going to buy groceries. They don't worry about things, their clothes. They know at some point, all they say is, oh, my shoes can't fit me anymore. Or I want to have a burger for lunch. They know there's someone there to provide. The Bible says in the book of Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, that God is able to make this grace available and abundant. That while he has made that grace abundant, we will abound in his good works. He did not ask us to provide. He is the one making the provision. We are just walking in that provision. And we are abounding in those good works. So a father has the capacity to provide. And it's a capacity that is inherent in every man. Every man has the capacity to provide. That's why the Bible speaks about men submitting. Then it's very hard for men to submit. Women, it's very easy for us to love. But women don't submit. It's very hard for men to love because they think that they are the ones doing all the work. But in many ways that man, the one who is the lover of all and the father of all, appreciates men. That's why he replicated himself in men as the one who has the capacity to provide. It says, and forgive us our debts. Fathers are very forgiving. Even as they provide discipline, they make allowance to forgive. giving people. Period. Mothers, we slide through that. But the next time that child does the same thing, we remind that child, didn't you do this 2 days ago? But men forget it. They don't even remember. They take it as a new offense and deal with it as a new offense. They can say the same thing over and over. The child does the same thing over and over, and they look for very creative ways to deal with children's, inadequacies. And the two things I learned while I studied the scriptures. There's something called forgiveness, and there's something called forbearance. So everybody has the capacity to forgive. What is forgiveness? Just correcting an error. But forbearance is what is the most difficult thing. Forbearance is creating a system whereby the person does the same thing over and over, but you forgive. You have even forgiven before that started. It's a higher form of forgiveness. And that is forbearance. And fathers have that forbearance. It's what I just spoke about. Mothers forgive, but they don't forget. Fathers forbear. Look, you will do it again. I'm ready to forgive you. So when the Bible says, when Jesus Christ says, forgive us our debts, he knows that there's a system that God has created in heaven. The Bible even tells us that for God so loved the world, he gave. Even before you and I ever thought we were going to be sinners, he had already given, he had created a system whereby we will come into his light. The Bible says, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. If that is not a root of love, I do not know what else to call it. That system has been created by God for fathers. As we celebrate fathers, we celebrate the spirit and the system of forbearance in fathers. Fathers hold on to love, even in the place of them dealing with a lot of things, tugging at them from left to right, from side to side, from society to home, to the workplace, to ministry, everything, they still create a system and an order of forbearance. It says, and lead us into temptation, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. The Bible speaks in the book of, it says, do not say in the book of James that God is tempting me, for God is not a tempter of evil. Fathers, I have spoken about fathers being providers, capacity, imbibing values, nurturing, supporting, and all of these qualities or characteristics are done because they don't want their children looking for these things outside. Temptation is when you go outside of the norm. When you go looking, when you go seeking for something outside of the norm. A father would never lead a child into temptation because they create a safe haven for that child. They create a safe system. You teach your children the value so they don't go and learn it outside. You teach your children respect to being courteous so that they don't disregard other people while they meet them in life. You teach your children the values of relationships so that they're not being taught anything outside of your norm. I have spoken that the concept of fatherhood varies across the continent. But one thing is certain, every father is, foundation is built on love. And the Bible says, perfect love casts out fear. When there's love for a father, the child is not afraid. The child will never go wrong. You run the risk, but you will never go wrong. The child will always go back to the father. Always go back to the father. Because that's where the source is. That is where the root of everything starts. That is the pillar. That is the foundation of everything that we are and everything that we will be. So as Jesus taught his disciples, he made them to understand one thing, that the Lord's Prayer is not a recitation, but it's the concept, the definition, and the value and the worth of a father and a son's relationship. Because indeed, prayer is not what we do. Prayer is a communication. It's our constant, every day. If I speak to Leanne, I'm having a prayer with her. That is what prayer is, a communication. One will speak and one will respond. So when we go to our fathers as children, But when we go to my father, I didn't have the privilege of having a father, but I have the privilege of having a husband, because God is so good. He knew I couldn't go into this life without a father. So he provided one in the person of my husband. And as many of us, some of us, like Leanne, her grandfather is a father. Even she has a dad, whether she loves him or she doesn't, he's still her dad. You know, I share a testimony. She wasn't a very close friend of mine, but she was someone I knew. And she had a very tempestuous relationship with her dad. They hated each other. But when this girl's father died, she cried so much. And everybody wondered, why? So someone took the courage to ask her, why are you crying so much? But you hated this man. And she said, who am I going to hate now? I have nobody to hate now. I enjoyed hating my father. So regardless of whatever we think, a father is pillar. A father is the foundation. And the love of a father can never be overemphasized. The father is the one who is the source, the provider. He has the capacity. He's the one who is accountable. He's the one who is trustworthy. He's the one who will not leave his children. He's the one that will imbibe the values, the culture, and the system. He creates order in his home. So even as we celebrate fathers today, we look to the one who is the father of all. The Bible calls him the father of all spirits. He is God the Father in Jesus Christ the Son, given to us in grace by the Holy Spirit. We have an element of the Father in each and every one of us. Every day we manifest that in our personal lives, even in the church and in the body of Christ. So as we celebrate fathers, we will be thankful for the love of the Father. The Father we have in heaven, who has enabled all of us today to be fathers in our homes, to be fathers to people, spiritually, mental. Some of us are mentees of mentors. Some of us are fathers to people in our workplace. They might not tell you so much as many times. But like I said, we appreciate all the fathers in the house. And we thank God for the blessings of fatherhood. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are grateful. We thank you, Father, because we have a love that is unfailing in you. We thank you for your word that you have given us today. We thank you because we know that we can come to you and we will not be ashamed. We thank you, Father, because we know that you are the source, you provide, and above all, you love us. Father, we ask that you teach us to be good fathers, that you teach our fathers to be good fathers, you teach our sons to be examples of good fathers. Father, you teach, you equip, you enable, and you increase us all. Father, Lord, we thank you for every father who has played the role of a father figure in our lives. We ask that you strengthen them more and more, and you keep each and every one of us. We are grateful for this time. We thank you for Minister Andrew Lee's invocation. We thank you because, Lord, he has poured into us week after week as a spiritual father we do. We thank you that in this time, Father, that he will have many encounters, Father, with you. That, Lord, you will speak into his heart as a good father should. We are grateful for the rest of the service, and we thank you, Father Lord. Take all the glory, and it is yours. In Jesus' name, I have prayed. Amen.
We'll be taking the offering now.
Thank you. really thankful how for the money you are able to give us. Father, our giving reflects you on our souls. We pray it is with good measure, pressed on, shaken together, running over, will you pour into our hands. In Jesus' name, we pray.
Amen. Please remain standing. We're going to be singing our last song, 10,000 Reasons.
Join us for tea and fellowship after the service. And we wish you grace and peace be with you always.